contrasting physical and chemical differences between metals and the silicates. And one of those contrasting properties is melting temperature. In this figure, the horizontal axis is pressure in gigapascal. 1 gigapascal corresponds about 30 kilometers in the Earth's shallow mantle, and 135 gigapascals Earth's core mantle boundary pressure. And the vertical axis is the increase of temperature with a 1,000 K increment. And these different curves correspond to different melting temperature of mantle material. Well, for pure iron, this melting temperature is similar with pyrolite at Earth's at high pressure conditions. But for the iron light elements, you detect this melting temperature is significantly lower. And this gray shallow area is the mantle at geotherm. And the information that you can take from this plot is that the melting temperature of the metal light systems are lower than the solid dust of silicates at Earth's mantle conditions. And because of this melting temperature relations, making this rock assemblage possible, that is that metallic melt coexisted with the silicate solids and a significant proportion of Earth's mantle. And if you take from the perspective of this petrology that the centrifuge elements, including the moderately centrifuge elements like tungsten, were preferentially partitioned into this metallic liquid. Not only that, for the incompatible element in the silicate solid, for example, helium, could also be partitioned into this metallic melt, and therefore could be a potential source for the different aspects of geochemical anomaly. But if we take another aspect of this rock assemblage from the perspective is rock physics property, it could create several anomalies that due to this assemblage. For example, the metallic faces, their density are significantly higher than the mantle silicate minerals. And therefore, by adding small amount of the melt into this bulk assemblage, it could lead to different degree of density increase. And meanwhile, because this metallic liquid are liquid, they could cause S velocity reduction. I will come back to this rock physics in much more detail in the later part of the talk. And therefore, because of this metallic melt, silicate solid rock assemblage, it could create potential anomalies of the density increase and S velocity reduction, and the tungsten helium pressurely partitioned into the metallic phase. That in the today's talk, I'm going to address this metallic liquids from mainly from the experimental perspective, but using it to explain the geophysical observations we made, as well as the natural samples geochemistry that we have observed. So we will first start from a shallow part of the Earth's mantle, where we have some metallic phases samples, and with much more understanding of them, then we are gradually goes into a deeper part of Earth's mantle. And so first, let's start from shallow mantle. The metallic phases mainly occur as a sulfides, as a trap, as taken from the mantle xenolith samples, shown here in this optic image. They occur as the bright blobs, as the inclusions of the silicate minerals, or they occur at the interstitials of silicate grains. And they occur as iron nickel sulfur compounds with their metal sulfur near stoichiometry. And one of the questions for this sulfides that we obtain them from the samples and bring it to our lab is that those sulfides have experienced the upwelling and cooling, and they equilibrated as lower temperature sulfide assemblages. And it's not clear whether they occur as solid or liquid at the Earth's mantle source condition. So for the first investigation that I'm going to introduce today is about to investigate whether the sulfide occur as a monosulfide solid solution or sulfide melt in the Earth's mantle. And to achieve that goal, we synthesize this composition of sulfides to represent Earth's upper mantle sulfide composition. And we place this starting composition within different capsules. And then we squeeze the capsules under high pressure. And in this figure, they're showing the different steps of the experiment. In this figure, the horizontal axis is a non-dimensional time. The vertical axis is the increase of temperature. And then this experiment will perform in piston cylinder up to 3.5 gigapascals and up to 8 gigapascals by molten anvil. And in step one, we increase temperature of our experiments and the high pressure. In step two, we stayed at the mantle temperature conditions from several hours to days. And step three, we quench the experiment in fast rate. In step four, we collect our samples after the rain and analyze their compositions to reflect their high temperature pressure composition equilibrium. So these are some of the represented backscatter image that taken from experiments performed at 1.8 gigapascals with this composition of sulfide as a starting composition in a graphite capsules. And these eight different experiments were performed the same pressure, but listed with a 25 degrees C temperature increment. And this brighter part in this backscatter image is interpreted as sulfide melt, which has slightly higher nickel and copper concentration and slightly lower sulfur concentration. And this darker part in the backscatter image are interpreted as monosulfide solid solution that equilibrated with sulfide melt. As we can see that with the increase of temperature, the melt proportion gradually increases until all the sulfide solid diminishes. Then we keep this cook and look experiment. This is a result of one suite experiments performed in the quartz capsules, where they plot in this figure the horizontal axis of pressure, the vertical axis of temperature Celsius, and these triangles represent the experiment with only sulfide melt without any solid. And this circle symbols correspond to experiment with sulfide solid equilibrated with sulfide melt. And this diamond symbols correspond to experiment of sulfide solid only, melt free. Then we use the available experiment petrology constraint and fit in the Simons-Grasso equation, and therefore we could obtain a solid curve and a liquid curve for this composition of sulfide at this particular condition. And we are now the first group to explore this composition. There was another study much earlier before us through the Münster University group using exactly the same composition and explored the melting temperature up to 3.5 gigapascals. Well, the previous study showed a very similar solidus as we discovered, the liquid curve that went into the other direction. And we mapped very intensively in this area and did not find sulfide solid existence until the temperature dropped to about 1250 or 300 degrees C. On the other hand, we re-examined the previous study and then find that the bracket that constrained this curve, there are one or two experimental points that is not consistent with the supplementary information provided. If we take those two points off and switch it to the other interpretation, then we're expecting that this previous study liquid as curve that bend in a similar direction with us with an interlaboratory uncertainty less than 50 degrees C. And therefore, from this exercise, we could use this solid and liquid as curve constraint from this composition of sulfides and deploy it into Earth's mantle conditions to provide us information about the state of the sulfide in Earth's mantle source. In this figure, the horizontal axis is temperature in degrees C, the vertical axis is increase of depth, and this red line corresponds to mantle adiabat, and this shallow area corresponds to different continental geotherm. And here is the sulfide solid and liquid constraint from previous exercise that we can see that along the mantle adiabat, the sulfide only occurs one phase of sulfide liquid, and the sulfide solid and sulfide liquid cut through the significant proportion of the continental geotherm, including part of the zone that is natural diamond stability zone that is at the keel of continental lithosphere. And this exercise is the first exercise that is using comparable upper mantle sulfide composition at the upper mantle redox condition to show that sulfide melt could be potentially stable within the diamond stability zone from the experimental perspective. Although that sulfide melt stability within natural diamond stability zone has been previously suggested through trace elements analysis in the natural sulfides. And also, if we revisit this problem and compare different liquids that are constrained and lead to different interpretations of the fate of the sulfide at the Earth's along the mantle adiabat mantle source, is that the previous hypothesis that sulfide solid, sulfide liquid coexistence along the Bobber source is the reason, is one explanation for a fractionated patterns of platinum group elements does not hold from the from the phase stability perspective. So the take-home message for this part is that sulfide mainly occurs as one-phase liquid along the mantle adiabat, and the sulfide solid, sulfide melt, two-phase fractionation. There are many conditions in the continental geotherm could satisfy this condition. So now, next, let's go to the deeper part of Earth's mantle. For this part of the gray area corresponds to, the gray in the background corresponds to the continental geotherm gradient from the lower end to the higher end. The gray area intersects with the mantle adiabat according to the thickness of the continental lithosphere. The temperature of the continental geotherm that intersects with the mantle adiabat. Okay. So next, we are going to the deeper part of the Earth's mantle, where previous experimental petrology work suggests that the iron dispersion reaction occurred in the reduced part of Earth's mantle, where garnet and brichtonite could host more ferric iron, and the small amounts of iron or iron nickel alloys could be stable in the deeper part of Earth's upper mantle or the lower mantle. And from what we have in the Earth's upper mantle sulfides, we know that we have the metals with near metal sulfur stoichiometry. That if we make the prediction that iron nickel alloys are stable in deeper part of Earth's mantle, the question I'm going to address is that how does this composition transition occur from the near stoichiometry metal sulfide to pure metal? And how much is the impact of this system to the Earth's deep carbon? So to address this question, I'm going to address it in the following three steps. First, we are going to look at the iron nickel sulfur melt system and to study to see how much of the carbon it could be potentially stored in it. Next, I'm going to address the sulfide melt and olivine reaction at the Earth's mantle conditions. And then I'm going to use the calculations and the constraints we made to compare with the natural metals that we discovered from deep diamonds and discuss about the deep diamond formation process. So first, about the iron nickel sulfur melts and how much carbon could be potentially stored within these melts. So we perform experiments by using graphite capsules and with a varying composition of iron nickel sulfur melts with the suite of nickel iron ratio and metal sulfur ratio. So we use a graphite capsule, we're showing here in this optical image as a black part, and then we drill holes, different holes in one graphite capsule, and then fill each hole with one composition of iron nickel sulfur compounds. And then we squeeze the sample under high pressure and high temperature conditions and then quench the experiment. The graphite capsule provides us a carbon source, and there are different amounts of carbon dissolved in the iron nickel sulfur melts. Then we analyze the composition, analyze the carbon content of this quenched polycrystalline iron nickel sulfur carbon polycrystalline assemblage. So here is the experimental result. And in this figure, the horizontal axis is the sulfur mole fraction or metal sulfur ratio, where in the in the stoichiometry sulfides, the metal sulfur ratio is 1 and the sulfur mole fraction is 0.5. And in the vertical axis is the carbon content within the samples by weight percent. And these are the experimental results. And our investigation suggests that metal sulfur ratio is the first order of control for carbon solubility. And nickel iron ratio is a second order of control to the carbon solubility within this metallic melt. And temperature pressure has a much smaller influence on the carbon solubility within the iron nickel sulfur melts. And here is our explanation that we went to the thermodynamic model for the iron nickel sulfur melts. And from this previous iron nickel sulfur ternary melt system, it is assumed that there are 5 chemical species within this ternary system, that there are 3 elemental chemical species and 2 sulfide species. And these 5 species are bounded by the 2 reactions. And from these two chemical reactions, there are two equilibrium constants, that is a function of temperature in this exercise. And therefore, we can calculate the different mole fractions of each corresponding chemical species at a particular bulk iron nickel sulfur composition. And here is one of the calculations that we took from this thermodynamic model, is that in this plot, we fixed the nickel and iron ratio as 1. This is the calculation performed at 1400 degrees C and get the corresponding equilibrium constant. And in this plot, the horizontal axis is sulfur mole fraction, where the monosulfide is about 0.5, and the vertical axis is different mole fraction of different chemical species. And then the different curves correspond to the equilibrated chemical species abundance at that particular bulk concentration of the iron nickel sulfur melt. And as we can see that with the increase of the bulk abundance of sulfur in the system, the sulfur species concentration gradually increases, and the elemental iron and nickel chemical species mole fraction decreases. And in this exercise, we were considering carbon. We assume that the carbon bonds with elemental iron chemical species and the nickel chemical species as different carbide species. And in this exercise, we also considered carbide sulfide non-ideal mixing. And then we used this thermodynamic database and then compare with our experimental results. So these two curves correspond to a iron-free or nickel-free system with their amount of carbon that it could be dissolved in this composition of iron nickel sulfur melt. So although it is not a perfect iron nickel sulfur ternary thermodynamic system, thermodynamic model, but it could explain the observations that we made of the carbon solubility drop through the decrease of a metal sulfur ratio via this thermodynamic model. So from this exercise, we could expect that the sulfides with a high metal sulfur ratio could potentially store a large amount of Earth's carbon. But the question is, what is the metal sulfur ratio or nickel iron ratio in the Earth's silicon mantle? So to investigate this process, this question, we performed calculations by reacting metallic sulfide melt with olivine. And in this exercise, we assume that there are a trace amount of sulfur in the Earth's mantle. And because sulfur solubility within the silicon minerals is at the ppb level, and therefore, although there are hundreds of ppm of sulfur in the Earth's mantle, they mainly reside in this accessory phase of sulfide. And for the iron nickel, it's different because the major reservoir for iron nickel are within the mantle olivine. And therefore, in this exercise, we allow the iron nickel to lose or gain between these two phases. And then through this exercise, we are trying to calculate the composition of the iron nickel sulfur melt. So the first constraints we can provide to constrain the system is through the mass balance of iron and nickel. That is, if we assume that a given composition of sulfur in the system, we could calculate is the mole abundance of molar abundance of this sulfur melt, and then we could assume the amount of the molar abundance of olivine in Earth's mantle. And through this exercise, we could use this composition, the iron and nickel composition within iron nickel sulfur melt, or the iron and nickel olivine abundance within the olivine, and use the mass balance to provide the first constraint. And later on, we do another exercise that's independent from the mass balance, that is to calculate the equilibrated composition pair of olivine and iron nickel sulfur melt composition. So here is how we do it, is that we'll go to the reactions that involve of the relevant chemical species, and then we calculate the Gibbs free energy of the reaction and build a connection of the activity of different chemical species. And next, we bridge the connection between the activity and the composition through the activity coefficient, which is taken through the currently available thermodynamic database for the silicates as well as for the metallic melts. And then with this information, we get the corresponding activity coefficient and build the connection between activity and composition. Then we put this result back to this previously reaction. And therefore, through this exercise, we could build a connection of the composition of iron nickel sulfur melt and the equilibrium composition of olivine under the given conditions. So from the exercise of mass balance, we can obtain two reactions. And then through the exercise of a thermodynamic calculation, we could obtain another two equations that are independent from each other. Then we solve these four equations simultaneously at the same time, and therefore we get a unique solution of the composition of iron, nickel, sulfur melt, and the olivine composition at the given PtFO2 conditions. And here is the PtFO2 path that I used in this exercise. In this figure, the horizontal axis is mantle redox, the vertical axis is increase of pressure by gigapascal, and this different bracket corresponds to mantle redox condition calculated from mantle xenoliths. And this different this curve corresponds to the mantle oxygen fugacity calculated from the garnet pyrrhotite as well as the mellow saturation. And then we use this curve to put into the previous exercise for the calculation. And where this will be noted later on, that is at this part that is have exciting results, that is near the iron-Wustad buffer. And here is the calculation results for the olivine composition with the increase of depth in the Earth upper mantle. In this figure, the horizontal axis is the modal abundance of the nickel olivine within olivine and the iron olivine within mantle olivine. And the vertical axis increase of depth. As we can see that as we start from the average upper mantle olivine, with increase of depth, the olivine loses both nickel and iron. But they lose in different proportions. And for there are higher proportion of nickel that lost from this olivine, and a small proportion of iron lost from the iron olivine. However, if we look at the total abundance of iron and nickel within this olivine, the iron is about 20 times more abundant than nickel within the olivine. So although the iron and nickel, they lost in different proportion within this olivine, for the total mass of iron loss outweigh that of the mass of nickel. So for the olivine, loses both iron and nickel. For the corresponding metallic phases through the calculation, it receives this iron and nickel. In this figure, the vertical axis is increase of pressure. The horizontal axis is the mass of the metals within the iron nickel sulfur melt with a given different assumption of sulfur in Earth's upper mantle. And this different dots or brackets corresponds to the increase or the acceptance, the metal, that the loss from the olivine with the increase of depth. So keep the constant mass of sulfur within this iron nickel sulfur melt, the total mass of the sulfide could increase by almost an order of magnitude as the mantle becomes more reduced. And there are several previous exercises that pioneering the work to investigate to interpret the reduced composition of sulfide melt in the Earth's mantle, and they should really take great credit for it. But there are some different approaches that we approach this question and lead to different interpretations. In the previous exercises that to investigate the reduced composition of sulfide melt, they assume the fixed amount of iron nickel total mass, for example, 1,000 ppm in the Earth's mantle. And for the mass of sulfur is also assumed, for example, 150 ppm, 200 ppm, or 250 ppm. And then through this assumed amount of mass of these two elements, of these two group of elements, then could get the metal sulfur ratio. But if we use this through the exercise, then the composition of the reduced sulfur melt depends on the amount of the sulfur that we assume in the system. But in our exercise, we're taking in a different approach. We will assume a different amount of sulfur in the system. We do not fix the amount of the iron nickel within the iron nickel sulfur melts. We allow the iron nickel to loss again through the between the metal phases and the olivine phases until they reach equilibrium. And therefore, the amount of metal phase within this sulfide are not constant. They are evolving with the time. And the controlling factor for the metal sulfur ratio is the oxygen fugacity, according to our investigation. Mm. And then for this 1 atmosphere pressure, as we compare with the carbon solubility data at the from the experiment data up to 7 gigapascals, it had a reasonable explanation. But with the higher pressures, that I don't know. But this is the best exercise we can make so far, and it requires. The thermodynamic data that we'll have to the accurate thermodynamic data will have to be modified through the further experiments. But for the trend of iron, for example, the iron metal activity and nickel metal activity with the composition of sulfide should still be valid with a higher pressure. That is, with the increase of sulfur total abundance within the sulfide composition, the elemental iron, elemental nickel activity should decrease. So the general trend still holds, but the specific process needs more verification. Okay, so through this exercise, we could our interpretation is that within the reduced part of Earth's mantle, the near iron woodside, the metal, the metallic melt that deviate from the metal sulfur stoichiometry. And then let's look at the natural samples that from the work right here at Carnegie. And from these natural samples that we get the inclusions that dissolved in the lower temperature stable assemblages as iron nickel alloy, as the different carbides and the sulfide. And then we could reconstruct the composition of this metallic liquid, which shows high metal sulfur ratio. And with the carbon content that is near to the carbon saturation as the experiment that investigated. So this reduced form of the sulfides are very significant evidence for the existence of this reduced form of the metallic melt in the Earth's mantle. And for this sulfide, with this reconstructed composition, it has low nickel iron ratio with a nickel divided by nickel plus iron ratio about 0.2. And this is relatively low. And not only in this deep diamonds that we captured the iron nickel sulfur carbon liquid, but also we captured the majorated garnet. And when majorated garnet has high iron magnesium ratio and high calcium content. And this indicates that it is ecologic in origin. And so for this exercise, that we are going to use the nickel iron ratio as a tracer to see that is it possible that there are some additional component added in the system that other than ecologite. So to do this exercise, we calculate the nickel iron ratio in the sulfide through in the peridotite assemblage through through this reaction, and the KD is expressed as iron nickel distribution coefficients between the sulfide phases and the olein phases. And then in this figure, the horizontal axis is sulfur mole fraction, where the monosulfide is about 0.5, and the vertical axis is nickel divided by nickel plus iron ratio. And in the Earth's upper mantle, sulfide trapped as diamond inclusions, for those sulfides that occur as a peridotitic in origin, that they have a high nickel divided by nickel iron ratio in this range. And for this sulfides that equilibrated with find within the ecologic origin within the upper mantle sulfides, upper mantle diamonds, that they have low nickel divided by nickel iron ratio. So that is what occurs in Earth's upper mantle. But with the more reduced part of the Earth's mantle, there is iron disproportionation that pushes iron outside from the ecologite entering into iron nickel sulfur melt. And therefore, the iron nickel sulfur melt becomes more and more metal rich. And there are corresponding change of the nickel iron ratio too. And the three different dashed lines correspond to the calculations that we made, assuming a different KD that I showed in the previous slide. And this three different solid curves correspond to the acceptance of iron within the iron nickel sulfur melt of this metallic liquid, because in the ecologic system, that all the nickel are already preferentially stored within the iron nickel sulfur melt. And through our calculation, we suggest that this diamonds that are showing from the reconstructed composition of the metallic faces within the deep natural diamonds from the work of right here at Carnegie, that does not seem to could be only explained through its equilibrium with eclogite. So there might be alternative interpretation is that there is involvement of the pyrrhotite component with it. Although pyrrhotite silicon minerals were not captured within the diamond inclusions. So based on that, we propose an alternative parallel hypothesis for the formation mechanism of the deep diamonds. Plotting this figure, the horizontal axis is nickel mole fraction, and the vertical axis is carbon solubility, and with the different circles corresponds to different experiments that with the metal sulfur ratio is the controlling factor for carbon solubility. And we propose that this iron nickel sulfur carbon liquid were originally equilibrated with the pyrrhotite and then migrated to eclogite. And it is through this oxidation process that alter the metal sulfur ratio and therefore pushes carbon out of the metallic liquid and precipitate the deep diamond. So it is this oxidation process that we propose of how this this deep, large diamonds were formed through this redox gradient. So with the available thermodynamic calculation that we made and the relevant experiments we performed, and here is our interpretation of the storage of Earth's deep carbon. In this figure, the vertical axis is increase of depth. The horizontal axis is the amount of bulk carbon in Earth's mantle. And we show the different stable assemblages. In the shallow part of the Earth's mantle, the iron nickel sulfur liquid has near metal sulfur stoichiometry and therefore has extremely limited carbon solubility. And with the increase of Earth depth and the decrease of oxygen fugacity, the metal sulfur ratio deviates from the stoichiometry, and there are more amount of carbon could be potentially stored within this iron nickel sulfur melt. And whether carbon saturated depends whether graphite or diamond that could coexist within the system depends on how much of carbon that there is in Earth's bulk carbon. So last, let's dive into the deepest part of Earth's mantle. I'm showing that the potential effect of these small amounts of this high metal sulfur ratio metallic melts to create observable geophysical and geochemical anomalies. So I'm going to investigate the large low shear velocity provinces, or LSVPs, which are two blobs shown here through the global seismic topography as they are laying from the Earth's core mantle boundary and then vertically up to 1,500 kilometers above the Earth's core mantle boundary. And they are characterized by S velocity reduction and the correlation between boson velocity and the shear wave velocity and the potential elevated density, and it requires temperature and the composition difference to explain these anomalies. So the previous hypothesis for the formation of large low shear velocity provinces are the accumulation of subducted oceanic crusts as well as the crystallization of dense basal magma ocean with the silicates, dense silicates with a high iron magnesium ratio. And in this figure, we show that small amounts of metal melt within the silicate solids could create certain amounts of S velocity. Not only depends on the amount of a melt within the system, but also highly related to the melt geometry. That is showing here as the different curves with different lines. And for example, if this melt that occurs a perfect isolated melt inclusions that distributed along the silicate solids, 1% metallic melt could cause 1% S velocity reduction. But if they occur more close to the geometry of a melt film, then 1% metallic melt could cause a higher degree of S velocity reduction. So this process could not only cause an S velocity reduction, but depending on the amount of the metallic melt within this bulk assemblage, it could also cause density increase. So we use this bulk rock assemblage to explain the observations that we have made through the large low shear velocity provinces. So one crucial question here is that what is the geometry of this metallic melt? And later on, what is the mobility and migration of this metallic melt? That is related to, in the hydrostatic conditions, the dihedral angle of this metallic melt along the silicate solid surface. That if the dihedral angle is less than 60 degrees, the small amount of melt tend to weld all the grain boundaries and form an interconnected network. And in this case, the metal has high density, and if their dihedral angle is low, then they are going to form interconnected network and drain into deeper part of the Earth or all the way to Earth's core. So previous exercise when investigating the dihedral angles suggests that for the one atmosphere experiments of the sulfides within the olive matrix, that the dihedral angle is related to the oxygen-free gas system or the oxygen content that is dissolved within this sulfide melt. And there are also previous exercises through Dunman animal cell experiments at much higher pressures to indicate that with increase of pressure, that the dihedral angle decreases with depth. And this is the hydrostatic conditions. But there's another component that we should take into consideration is that in the non-hydrostatic conditions, that shear stress could promote the melt to form interconnected network, even though the melt have high surface tension. So we have different interpretations from the previous experimental interpretation from the Dunman animal cell experiment. And here is what the pioneering great work, very challenging work, that was done from Stanford University group, where they used about 10% iron melt within 90% Bridgman matrix. And here is the 3D X-ray tomography showing here of the red part showing the distribution of the iron melt within the Bridgman matrix. And in this exercise, the dihedral angle that from the statistics show that the dihedral angle are low at the high pressure conditions, about 30 degrees. However, within this assemblage, there are also some isolated iron melt. So our interpretation, rather than that this iron melt form interconnected network due to its low surface tension, but because of the we interpret that the iron melt form interconnected network because of the shear stress that created within the Dunman animal cell experiment up to gigapascal scale. While in the Earth, the real condition is in megapascal scale, it's much smaller. And so this experiment, we suggest that does not really reflect the hydrostatic condition of the dihedral angle of the metallic melt within the silicate solid matrix. This is great pioneering work, but we don't think that we know the specifically of the surface tension of the metallic melt at this very extreme high pressure conditions. And it requires more future experiments to define this process. So we propose that small amount of metallic melt with the now with an unknown geometry within the silicate matrix yet to explain the observed large low shear velocity provinces. But how does this metallic melt were formed and being trapped and stayed? And here is our hypothesis. Our hypothesis is that this metallic melt formed in the deep Earth magma ocean after Earth's core formation. And they are formed because this comes from the idea of the Hydean mat, that during the magma ocean crystallization, because of the sulfur solubility into the newly formed silicate crystals is at the PVB level. So making the residual silica liquid more and more sulfurish until at some point that it reaches sulfur saturation and precipitate sulfide. And our hypothesis is that they precipitate sulfide that has high metal sulfur ratio. So for this reduced form of sulfur melt that precipitated from the early magma ocean, that's how they were formed. But the question is that how they are being trapped within the Earth's mantle rather than segregating the Earth's core. Because we did a calculation to show that if this metallic melt that exposed into the convective magma ocean, they are going to coalesce with each other into forming larger droplet sizes where its settling velocity will overcome the convective velocity of the magma ocean. And therefore, as long as they are exposed in the magma ocean, they are going to sinking through the magma ocean and end up in Earth's core. So they won't be trapped. So our hypothesis suggests that this process might have occurred before they are being trapped. And we propose that at the pressure near Earth's core mantle boundary, the newly formed silicate crystals that has lower density than the residual dense silica liquid, which is supported through the recent work of the work in recent years by first principle calculations. And for the uniform silicate crystals, the floating above the residual silicate dense silicate liquid trap this metallic melt as inclusions or at the interstitials of the silicate grains. And this process occurred and continued until the end of magma ocean crystallization. And therefore, this small amount of metallic melt that trapped within the silicate matrix, solid matrix, occurs only as one layer above the Earth's core mantle boundary in the early Earth process. And the topography of this layer, or the original layer of LSVPs, were reshaped through the mantle convection into their current topography. And we also propose that we also propose that noble gases could partially stored within this iron nickel sulfur melt or the adjacent silicate crystals. And because of the elevated density contrast between the LSVPs and the mantle, they are not being fully mixed within the mantle convection, and therefore could they preserve their primordial geochemical signatures. But the one thing I should add here is that this mantle convection process that create a shear stress that, although we do not know specifically of the surface tension or the geometry of the metallic melt, that could potentially redistribute the distribution of the metallic melt within the LSVPs through time, and therefore create a gradient or non-homogeneous or heterogeneous distribution of this metallic melt, and therefore could create a heterogeneous distribution of density elevation and S velocity reduction. And from the higher and higher resolution of the LSVP global seismic tomography, we could gradually get an idea of that this is likely the case that within the LSVPs, there are different gradient of S velocity and potentially also gradient of density. That in this hypothesis that we explained is due to the different distribution of this metallic melt within the large low shear velocity provinces. So here is the conclusion and a summary cartoon of today's talk, that for this iron nickel sulfur melt phase, iron nickel sulfur phase, they mainly occur as the melt along the mantle adiabat, and they also occur as a solid-solid sulfur melt fractionation process occur along the continental geotherm, and their composition and near stoichiometry at the shallow mantle conditions, but with increase of depth and decreased oxygen fugacity, their metal sulfur ratio gradually increases, and so does the corresponding nickel iron ratio evolves with the oxygen fugacity. And our calculation only consider the metallic melt and olivine reaction up to the olivine stability field, and although both the silicate solid thermodynamic database needs more improvement and future work, and also the iron nickel sulfur ternary system at high pressure needs future work. But for our exercise, we show that potentially large amount of carbon could be stored into the iron nickel sulfur melt because of the higher activity of iron chemical species and nickel chemical species within the iron nickel sulfur melt, and therefore we propose that significant amount of Earth's deep carbon could be stored into this metallic phase. And not only that by equilibrating with the peridotite that migrate to the ecologite, and this redox process could also change the metal sulfur ratio and pushes carbon out of the methane liquid and form Earth's deep carbon. And finally, the distribution of these metallic phases in Earth's mantle might not be homogeneous. There will be bimodal distribution of these metallic phases that not only create geophysical anomalies, but also geochemical anomalies. And the migration of these metallic phases could also cause cause great variation in the Earth's mantle redox. So that's all about my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
example. So your question, so may I rephrase your question so the audience could hear it? So your question is that where does the sulfur come from in this, for example, in the deep diamond formation process? Whether this sulfur, are this sulfur or the early sulfur that comes from the early earth process or through the sulfur that bring up by the subduction process. So my interpretation for that is that so far we don't know that where the sulfur comes from. We only provide a petrological constraint by at this reduced mantle redox conditions, what is composition equilibrium with the peridotite. So from only from petrology, I could not provide the origin of those sulfur. But we only constrained through the mantle redox condition. So my answer is that I don't know. Yes, Steve. Steve's question is that what is the driving force for the migration of this metallic melt from the hypothesis of the peridotite assemblage, peridotite source to the ecologite source. So my interpretation for that is that the migration first by distance is not far. It's a short distance migration. And the second, for the migration process taking into the whole picture of the migration in entire mantle, not only it is related to the surface tension of this metallic melt at the silicate solid surface, and particularly this condition is much lower pressures compared with the LSVPs. And so another factor is the shear force that of the deformation of the rock. Actually, that is what was proposed in your paper too. So the shear force is a very important factor in migrating the metallic melt, particularly along the subduct slabs. So the question is whether this mechanism is only applies to deep diamonds, and does it apply to the shallow diamonds? So my explanation is that this redox change of carbon precipitation forming diamonds only could apply to deep diamonds in reduced conditions. Because for the continental diamonds, the sulfides that we discover, they have their sulfur mole fraction or metal sulfur ratio of 1, so the composition is here. So they have extremely limited carbon solubility within the sulfides. So that could not, it could precipitate large diamonds, the amount of volume that it requires to form this sulfide melt are astronomical volume and is not realistic. So this hypothesis only applies to the part of the mantle that has the large redox of gradient. Sorry, I didn't get your question that why the silly. And yes. So let me rephrase your question. So your question is that how much amount, what's the mass of the sulfide that it requires to generate so much carbon? Could I rephrase in that way? Okay. So this is the metallic melt phase that we composition that discovered from these diamonds. So what we propose is that the carbon solubility within this melt, carbon solubility equilibrium, the carbon solubility are related to the metal sulfur ratio. So the metal sulfur ratio could generate from much higher to here. And for the Earth's, so this high metal sulfur ratio, even we take into account several hundreds of ppm of sulfur corresponds to correspond to like what I showed in the calculation, that order of magnitude or higher mass of this metallic phase in Earth's mantle. And so that's the amount of carbon it could potentially host. And therefore, by changing the metal sulfur ratio, that drops the carbon solubility. And this is the difference of this is the amount of carbon that squeezed out from the liquid to precipitate as diamond. And this is a continuing process that going on that formed the precipitate and grow these big diamonds. So that's my interpretation for it. Varies from, I just do a quick calculation in my mind, it's from, like I said, 5 to 10 to 1 or 2 orders of magnitude or more. Depends on which metal sulfur ratio is choosing starting with and end with. Now we know the ending point that it could be here, but depends on which part of the. Yeah, we discuss later on, and probably need some simple calculation to. we could define better. Yes, Steve. that's your diamonds. It is starting from reduced. In this hypothesis, it starts from more reduced and becomes slightly more oxidized, but this oxidation result is still more reduced than the continental lithosphere by several orders of magnitude of FO2. Thank you.